have seen, ears have heard. What's recorded in God's word? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, mighty God is he. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise his name. Hallelujah. Thank you. He is wonderful, isn't he? He's wonderful. It's good to see you back there, Bruce. It's the right thing. All right. All right. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your truth because it sets us free. We thank you for anointing because it breaks the yoke. We thank you for power because it destroys the enemy's strongholds. And so, Lord, this day we receive your power, your anointing, and your truth to be able to speak into this world hope and the ability to rise above the circumstances of evil that come against us. Thank you for this Mother's Day. Thank you for every mother. Thank you for every woman with the potential of motherhood. And help us, Lord, to be able to bring honor to that wonderful name and title, Mother. And we receive that in Jesus' name. Amen. For all of you who are watching us on television, we appreciate the fact that you're with us. You can be part of our church family, especially for all those folks up in the Reading area. We're getting good reports from people there, and we're just honored to be able to be part of your life with the truth of the gospel. Always know that you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And it is our hope that we never compromise that truth in any way or fashion. And we receive that in Jesus' name. Well, these special days, you know, Christmases can be wonderful, and Easter's, and Mother's Day, and Father's Day. They had the potential to be so wonderful. But, you know, a lot of people in this earth didn't have good mothers. A lot of people in this earth lost their mothers. There's a lot of things that can bring sadness, too, on special days. And so before we ever approach it, it is not our desire to hurt anybody or to dig up bad memories from the past, but it is our desire to deliver the truth, because it is the truth, when known and applied, that brings freedom into our lives. It is the truth that sets us free. And some of that truth might seem hard, especially in a culture like we face today, a culture that is so depraved in many ways, where so many people have been taught lies, they have believed the lies, they have acted upon the lies, and now they're carrying around great pain and great hurt and great distress within their psyches and within their spirits and even within their bodies because of sin. The wages of sin is death. Sin is a transgression against God's truth. That's all it is. Sin is missing the mark. It is not living in accordance with the principles that God created when he created us. There's a right way and a wrong way. People want to say, well, there's a right way, a wrong way, and then there's my way. No, if your way isn't right, then it's going to be wrong. It's either right or wrong. You say, no, it can't be black and white like that. It is black and white like that. God is good and the devil's bad. Righteousness brings blessings. Sin brings curses. And so we want to walk in the truth and in the light as he is in the light. Well, if you turn to Genesis chapter 1 with me. Genesis chapter 1. Everything you ever need to know about right and wrong pretty much can be found in the book of Genesis. It's the book of beginnings. It's the book where all the patterns were laid down. And we live in a world that is so mentally messed up that people are being confused with animals, and animals are being confused with people, and many times animals have priority over people. And I sit back in amazement and think, what are people thinking? Why do they think that way? And it's because they have made a decision to not believe in God, not to take the word of God as truth, and they have become simple in their reasonings. They have become foolish in their application of life's opportunities, and it brings great pain. So, Genesis chapter 1, we're going to look at Genesis, we're going to look at Corinthians, we're going to look at 1 Timothy, and we're going to look at 2 Timothy. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, well, he either did or he didn't. If there's no God, then he didn't say it. But if there is a God, then he did say it, okay? God said, let us, plural, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, make mankind in our image. Now, he's doing this at the end of the fifth day where he had made all these other things. He'd made the fish, he'd made the birds, he'd made the beasts. This is a special creation. It's distinct from the animals. We're not animals. We are spirits that inhabit a body that was created in the image of God. So if we're ever going to understand ourselves, I almost feel sorry for kids going off to school and they're wanting to major in psychology or psychiatry or social work or some of these areas, because they're going to be taught a bunch of untruths which they will assume to be true, and then they will try to act on that thing, those things which they've been taught, to set people free from the dilemmas that they've gotten themselves into because they have committed sins. But you can't call it sin, and you can't use the name of Jesus, therefore there's no power there to break it. And so it just goes on and on and on and on. And it becomes, I would think, very discouraging for them after a while. But God said, let us, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, make mankind in our image. He didn't make the whales in his image. He didn't make the birds and the beasts in his image. He made man in his image, after our likeness, and let them have complete authority over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the tame beasts, and over all the earth, and over everything that creeps upon the earth. So who has dominion? Who is it built for? Man has dominion. The earth and the fullness thereof was made for man, not man for it. It's like Jesus talking about the Sabbath. He said, man was not made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. And so God created man in his own image. In the image and likeness of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. All right, now this is very, very, very important. Male and female. A female is a mother. A male is a father, and they were created differently. They're not the same. Why not? Why can't they be the same? Because they were created male and female, each with different types of personalities, each with different types of emotions and hormones. They were made to be different. A man was meant to be a father, and a woman was meant to be a mother. You say, well, I'm a man and I want to be a mother. You aren't going to be, because you are not capable of being a mother. You might take on some motherly duties, you might take on some motherly traits, but you are not a mother. A mother is a female. And it is amazing how much man works and strives to do away with the way God made it. I heard just recently where some folks are thinking about being able to fertilize eggs and put them inside of a man so that the man will be able to have a child. Well, you know, the Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard. That's not the way it was supposed to work. And so whenever you try to do things like this, you say, I'm going to make God go away. I'm going to make his laws go away. It's not going to happen. You can mess around with it, but it's just not going to work, because God made them male, female. That needs to get really affixed in your mind. All right? And then it says, so God created man in his own image, in the image of likeness of God, and he created him male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, using all of its vast resources in the service of God and man. Now you see, you have this movement in the world today that we're not supposed to be using the resources. Leave them alone. Don't get that gas out of the earth. Don't chop down those trees. Don't use the resources. We're running out of them. You're not ever going to run out of them. Because before that happens, there will be a new heaven and a new earth. God created this earth with everything that it needed right up until the time of the rapture, the tribulation, the millennium, and ultimately new heavens and a new earth. We have been given a command to use the resources and to make life better for our fellow human beings. It's not wrong to have a toaster that operates off electricity that was created through the use of oil or coal. It's not wrong. But you see, our minds have become so influenced by secular antichrist dogma that we now are believing foolish things. And so those resources, see, everything starts as a resource. The suit I have on probably started out as either coal or oil. It's not wool. So since it's probably a polyester blend of some kind, it was either made from coal or it was made from oil or something like that. The things that we have are made from the resources that are here on the earth. God has given people an ability to understand the way things are put together and to be able to refine them and to manufacture them and to make life better. Is life better in some of these third world countries where people go to bed hungry? They live in hovels on dirt floors? Is life better there? Now, I know life doesn't consist of things, but at the same time, things can be used to make things better. And so we've been given this mandate to take the vast resources and use them. All right, this is Mother's Day. We're thinking about mothers. God made women. He made them in a certain way to be mothers, to make them affectionate, and to fulfill the needs of the children. Mothers are caregivers, lovers, providers, feeders. Mothers are special. You know, I was thinking about all the times that I was sick, and I was sick a lot as a child. And I can only remember about one time that my father ever came in to look at me, to care for me. It was always mother. It was always mom when I had a fever that would go to the bathroom and take a washcloth and put cold water on it and rinse it out and, you know, squeeze it out and bring it in and put it on my head and ask me if I was all right. It was mom when I had rheumatic fever that sat beside my bed and read me Bambi. That was a heart-wrenching time. She cried, I cried, but I've been able to shake that off. But it wasn't Dad. It was Mom. It was Mom, the one that was there. Now, every person, and I've used this a lot over the years, every person, according to Dr. Maslow, has basic needs. Every person. Every person. It's really hard to be the person you're supposed to be if you're just striving to get your own needs met. The Bible clearly teaches that if we will seek God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our might, He will meet all of our needs. My God shall supply all my needs according to His riches and glory. Well, what are those needs? Well, there's basically five categories of them. The first is physiological needs. You have to have water, you have to have food, you have to have shelter, and you have to have clothing. Physiological needs. And then we have to all be loved and feel like we belong. And then we have to feel safe. Safe in our persons, safe in our physical bodies. We have to feel safe. And then we need to be successful. We all need to achieve. We want to achieve. You know, when I was teaching school, there would be children every year. See, everybody has that need to achieve. And for whatever reason, they'd just given up on getting positive achievement through the regular school system. And so they said, well, I'm going to achieve. I'll be the worst kid in the school. I'll be whatever it is I have to be so that I can achieve. We see a lot of that, don't we, in the gang structure in this country. A lot of things come into play in the gang structure in this country, right? But we all have these needs that needs to be met. And in order for us to reach the pinnacle of what we were created for, and that is to no longer be a selfish person, to be a person who lives to serve others, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you, a person that becomes a giver, a person that becomes a champion for what is right and opposed to what is wrong, in order for us to get to that last level of need fulfillment, to become self-actualized, we've got to have the others met. Where does this begin? I think it begins with mom. I think mother is the ultimate provider of needs in the case of children. Let's look at this. Who is it that nurses the child? It's mom. It's not dad. Life flows from the mother into the child. It is the mother that is meeting the need for food, the need for water. It is the mother that is concerned for the most part, generally, about making sure that the child is clothed. And even though the shelter is provided generally by dad, mom is still there keeping it nice, keeping it clean, keeping it free of germs. That concerns mom normally more than it does the father. Okay, there is this aspect of nurturance that flows from the mother's heart and the way that she was put together and made. God made her female for a purpose and for a reason. So the child senses mom as being the provider of what it needs. I was talking with Tracy, I won't use her last name, but Tracy, and she and her husband adopted a little girl from a foreign country. And they told her she and her husband said, if the child won't look you in the eye, don't adopt them. Because they've already been damaged through the lack of, not food, but through the lack of being cared for and touched and loved. You know, you can give a child all the food they need, all these physiological things they need, but if they are not loved, they won't develop right. Everything needs to be touched. Wives need to be touched. Husbands need to be touched. Children need to be touched. Children need to be picked up and loved and touched. They need to know that they are loved and cared for, and just shoving something in their mouth is not good enough. They need to know that they belong to something. And I say, in our culture today, they say, well, there's lots of different kinds of families. That's true, but there's only one kind of family designated by the word. The perfect one. Not every family is going to be perfect. We don't have to live very long before we know sometimes dads are lost. They're lost to accidents. They're lost to disease. And now all of a sudden, here's mom, and she's got children, and she's got to bring those children along. And I've seen some of the most courageous mothers. If I was to pick out a mother of the year, some of them that went here in this church, they raised their children without dad in the home. But then the men of the church became surrogate dads, Royal Ranger commanders moved into that place, or different men and so forth. And those children were raised to become good, strong men and women themselves. That can happen. But the perfect ideal, as God created it, was that there would be a father, a husband, that there would be a wife, a mother, that they would have children, and that together they would create a home built on God's truth, where the children were trained up in the way that they should go, and when they were old, they wouldn't depart from it. And when there are deviations from this, it's a transgression against God's perfect way. And it's not impossible, but it's difficult. It's difficult to do it some way other than God's way, because he made them male, female, husband, wife, children, family. I was coming down here today, and I got this mental picture in my mind. Dad standing there with a musket and a coonskin hat on. Mom sitting there in the chair holding a baby and a little child standing beside them. And it's like, that's kind of the way it's supposed to be. Dad's going to have the gun and he's going to keep everybody safe. Mom is going to be there to nurture and to provide for and to take care of. And the family is going to work together as a unit. A unit. And when that family stays together, and the old saying was, the family that prays together stays together, and when that truth is provided in the home and the children are trained up in the way they should go and dad loves the mother the way Christ told him to in Ephesians chapter 5, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and demonstrates that love through protection, love, and caring, and mom submits to the husband because the church is to submit to the Lord Jesus Christ, and so the wife is to submit to the husband as long as he's walking in the truth of God's word. And when this is done, then the children can be brought up with this model of love and security, and they belong to something. What's your name? I'm a Moor. I belong to the Moor clan. I belong. I'm family. So every person has this love and belonging needs. Now the church can fulfill a lot of these. The church can fulfill a lot of these things, but ultimately the root is the family. Third thing is safety. Child needs to feel safe. When I was a kid, and there's this whole big thing now on bullying. Well, as long as I can remember, there's always been bullies. My dad had the way to handle that. He said, I had this kid that used to wait for me after school. His thrill in the morning when his eyes opened up was, tonight after school I'm going to get the pound on Woodson Moore. And I came home all messed up, shirt torn. My dad finally had enough of it, and he said, next time you come home that way, I'm taking you out behind the house, and I'm going to spank you with a switch till you can't sit down if you don't fight back. I was afraid of my dad because I'd been switched by him, and I knew what that was. So sure enough, here came the opportunity, and we fought back against the bully, and he never bullied me again. Stayed clear. Resist the devil, and he shall flee from you. But at the same time, bullying is wrong, and it needs to be dealt with, and I got bullied a lot when I was a kid. When I was in high school, I was good enough to make the traveling squads as a freshman, and the seniors resented that. So every time the coach was looking the other way, if they could trip me or push me down or hurt me, they did. And I would come home at night, and I'd say, not to my dad. No. I'd complain and groan to mom. Mom, they're so bad. I think I'm just going to quit. I'm just going to quit, Mom. I just had enough. And she'd say, oh, it'll be okay. You'll never remember it 100 years from now. She was wrong. I still remember it, but. And she said, it'll all be better before you're married. That worked whenever I was 12. Doesn't work anymore. Okay. But she would be the bastion upon which I cried and moaned and groaned and complained. Why? Because mom was filled with compassion. Dad was filled with justice. See? And you say, well, why is that? Because they were made that way. In the beginning, he made them male and female. And so mom was a place for love, acceptance. I was going to read 1 Corinthians 13, but for the sake of time, we won't. Love always thinks the best. It was probably about 4 or 5 years before mom passed away and went to be with God, with the Lord. I was back there and she said, "Son, you never did anything wrong." I thought, boy, does mom ever have selective memory. Because I did my share of wrong. But you know what love does? Love always thinks the best. Always. Always thinks the best. That's why when we started the school and we went down for our training and said, now if the child has a disciplinary problem, do not deal with the mother. Don't deal with them. Call the dad in. Because the mother will always be defensive and protective and will almost always think the best because she's put together that way. Love and belonging. Safety. Whenever I got messed up, I didn't go running home to dad. I ran home to mom. Hide behind her skirts. No, because mom would defend me. And we have safety needs. Mom, is this okay to eat? She said, I'm not so sure you should be eating that. Okay. I trusted mom. I trusted what she said because I knew that she loved me and she was going to keep me safe. It was mom that dispensed the medicine to me. It was mom that did the things that was necessary to keep me alive. It was mom that fixed breakfast. It was mom that laid my clothes out. It was mom that made my bed. It was mom that ripped the shoes off my feet and polished them because she didn't want to be embarrassed by her son going to school with shoes that wasn't polished. It was mom. It was mom that kept me safe. It was mom that gave me advice how to deal with the hurts and the woes that was there. Success and achievement. It wasn't necessarily something that was beat on me with, but all my great-great-aunts were teachers. Some of them were university teachers. My grandmother on my mom's side was a teacher. All my aunts were teachers. My mother was a teacher. And it was just there that you had to study hard in school. There's never any emphasis, you know, as such placed on it, but just the example was there. Study. My aunts would bring home materials that they were using in the one-room country school where they were teaching. And they'd give them to me when I was 4 and 5 years old. And they would teach me Aesop's fables and different things. And so when it came to success and achievement, the pressure was there, but nobody actually said anything. And in Missouri, they had something called a reading circle certificate. You started in first grade, and it ended in eighth grade. And every year, you read so many science books, so many history books, and so many fiction books. And, of course, the older you got, the more books it was required of you and the more difficult the reading. And my mother said to me when I was in first grade, you will get the reading circle certificate. Now, I enjoyed reading, but I probably would not have carried through on that other than my mother said, you will get the reading circle certificate. And so when I graduated eighth grade, I got the Missouri State certificate for reading all these different books. It really helped me. It increased my vocabulary. I've read every book probably there was on famous Americans. I mean, all the way from Kit Carson to Jim Bridger to Francis Marion and the Swamp Fox, from which the Patriot movie was made. And so, success and achievement. There was always this dynamic. You can do it. I don't care how. If it didn't go well today, you come back tomorrow, you can do it. A no-quit attitude was implemented in me. I was never allowed to escape. If I started something, I was to finish it. If I didn't like it, I didn't have to do it again. But if I started it, I was to finish it. You say, well, where do you get that from? Well, Jesus said any man that puts his hand to the plow and then turns back, he's not worthy of the kingdom. There is a principle involved there. That if you start something, bring it to a conclusion. This was taught. success, achievement. And then finally, you arrive at a place where if your needs have been met, you're not selfish and just concerned only about yourself, but you care about others. You want to see other people achieve. You want to see other people be accomplished. But in order for that to happen, you have to have your needs met. Now, moms, maybe you didn't have a good family life. More and more of that going on in this country because of the teachings on sexual immorality. More and more of that going on. More and more dysfunctional homes. More and more dysfunctional people. More and more murders. More and more gang-related activities. Why? Because there is a need to have your physical needs met, to have love and to belong to something. There is a need to feel safe, to have something around you to protect you, and you need to achieve. And if these things are not being met at the home level, the person will seek to find those needs somewhere else. And we want mothers to be mothers. We want you to stop being just concerned about yourself. You say, well, when do my needs get taken care of? Seek the Lord Jesus Christ and His principles and His truth first. And He will become your coverer and your protection. And you can go to God and say, look, this man that belongs to you, that is my husband, he is not doing right by me. I ask you to protect me, Lord. This situation is not right. You are my help in time of trouble. I want to take you over to Timothy, if you would go there. We're going to look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. Now, how many of you believe that we are at least approaching what the Bible would call the end of the age? I mean, we're at least approaching. We don't know how long and so forth. So if we're approaching the end of the age, or maybe we're into the end of the age, and maybe we're getting close to the end of the end of the age. All right, but there are certain things the Bible says will be happening at that time. 1 Timothy chapter 4 says, but the Holy Spirit distinctly and expressly declares that in the latter times, some will turn away from the faith, giving attention to deluding and seducing spirits and doctrines that demons teach. Now, we could take the entire service and preach on that. It could be false religions. It could be just false concepts that are being taught, antichrist concepts that are being taught that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. Think about the university picture and what young people are being taught in universities. You can actually go to some universities and take a course on pornography. You can go to courses where Christianity is defamed. It is thought of as being crazy and stupid, and we don't want to hear it. And if there isn't a solid base in that child's life when they go to college and they're living in a dorm and they're all caught up in dorm life, they can be swept into almost anything that's there. It's the time that we're living in. There was a time when somebody went to college, there were rules. There were rules of how you conducted yourself within the dorm. You didn't have co-educational living in the dorm. Guys' dorm was over here. Girls' dorm was over there. You didn't have guys and girls sharing showers and bathrooms. What you do now? Okay. And these situations that are being put into place in our time, you know, it's going to cause people to turn away from the faith, giving attention to deluding and seducing spirits and doctrines that demons teach, through the hypocrisy and pretension of liars whose consciences are seared, who forbid people to marry and teach them to abstain from certain kinds of foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and have an increasingly clear knowledge of the truth. That one phrase there, forbidding in marriage. That's puzzled me for a long, long time. I've never heard any teachings out there telling people that it was wrong to get married. But I shared that in first service, and Dr. Narowski came up to me. He said, you know, I just this past week got an email online dealing with that very concept of forbidding in marriage. It doesn't mean to forbid in marriage. It means to basically disannul the need for it. There's no need to get married. Well, that kind of changes that, doesn't it? Teaching people that there's really no need to get married. Just go ahead and be sexually involved and have sexual relationships. Just make sure that it's safe sex. And there's no need to get married. In fact, it's still not necessary to get married even if you're pregnant, because you can build a whole cottage economy around just getting pregnant and letting the state take care of you. No need for marriage. That's one of the signs of the end of the age. And it's one of the signs that is becoming more and more prevalent in our culture and in our society. What does that do? It destroys the nuclear family. It creates situations where dad's not there. There's no mother to speak of. And lots of times, these young girls aren't really the mother. It becomes their mother that becomes the mother. And so there's a whole breakdown in the system. And then you ask yourself, why are we having such lawlessness? Let me just share something with you. You don't realize, I don't think, the depth of the seeds of destruction that have been sown in this nation. If something was to happen to the economy, to where people who were on government subsidies no longer got that subsidy, there would be absolute chaos in the cities. Chaos. Why? Because there's nobody else to take care of the person. Turn over to 2 Timothy. Now remember, I started off, I didn't necessarily want to make anybody feel bad. You know, there are a lot of pastors that won't preach against sin because they don't want to make anybody feel bad. Well, we don't want to be speaking out against debauchery or drunkenness or lasciviousness or these things, because there's going to be people out there that's doing those things and you're going to make them feel bad. Well, they already feel bad because they're in the grips of sin and they're living with guilt every day. The only way that this guilt can ever be getting rid of, and it's not by going to a psychologist or psychiatrist and have them telling them, well, what you're doing, this whole concept of sin, it doesn't exist. It's just a bunch of old wives' tales out of the Bible. Just get rid of that. Get free from being this guilt feeling. Just do whatever you want to do. Well, see, God made us in His image. He put that guilt, that conscience down inside of us so that we would know when we are doing something that is going to be destructive to ourselves, that's going to destroy our life. Jesus came so that we could have life and we could have it more abundantly. He came so that we could be drawn out of the ways of darkness over into the ways of light, and this light, as it shone on our life, would direct us in right steps and right ways so that our decisions will bring happiness and joy and peace and fulfillment and achievement so that our needs can be met. He came to meet our needs. But they're only going to be met if we live properly. I don't think I'm wrong in that. And so we have these doctrines of demons that are teaching people no right, no wrong, no good, no bad. Just different strokes for different folks. Whatever seems right in your own eyes, do it if it seems to work. But it doesn't work. Open marriage doesn't work in the fulfilling of the basic needs of people. Only a commitment, a covenant, two people coming together in a covenant before God and saying, I'm going to love you as long as I live and you live, I'm going to love you, and I'm going to be faithful to you, and I'm going to forsake all others. Period. Now, our culture and society is filled with people who have violated that. What are they going to do to ever inherit the kingdom of God? They're going to have to repent. They're going to have to acknowledge the way I handled that back there was wrong. It was a violation of God's truth. I sinned. If we will confess our sin, He is faithful to forgive us. But if we won't acknowledge our sins, how can He forgive us? And so we have to come to grips, reading the Bible, going through the Word, say, whoa, I broke that one. I didn't do that one right. That was stupid. But if our pride won't let us raise a hand, come to the front of the church, make things right, acknowledge that we are sinners, we can never be born again. And if you aren't born again, you can't see the kingdom. And if you can't see the kingdom, you can't teach the kingdom. And if you can't teach the kingdom, you can't train up your child in the way that they should go so that when they're old, they won't depart from it. So that their life is not all messed up like we have messed our lives up. See? So, how are they going to know unless somebody tells them? Unless somebody preaches it? And how are they going to preach unless they're sent? So we've got to send people to where the lost are and have them preach the truth. And at the same time, the people who are being sent need to be people that are chosen to be sent by God. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. But understand this, that in the last days will come perilous times of great stress and trouble, hard to deal with, hard to bear. For people will be lovers of self and utterly self-centered. Motherhood is not lovers of self and not self-centered. A mother, in most cases, will be impelled to give their life for their child. That would be the natural inclination. You know, they will be without natural human affection, callous and inhuman, relentless and admitting of no truce or appeasement. They will be slanderers, false accusers, troublemakers, intemperate and loose in morals and conduct, uncontrolled and fierce, haters of good. It's a strong word, haters of good. They will be treacherous, betrayers, rash, and inflated with self-conceit. They will be lovers of sensual pleasures and vain amusements more than and rather than lovers of God. For although they hold a form of piety, true religion, they deny and reject and are strangers to the power of it or the authority of it, and their conduct belies their genuineness of their profession. Oh yeah, I'm a Christian. But then their conduct belies that profession. Avoid all such people. Turn away from them. For among them are those who worm their way into homes and captivate silly and weak-natured and spiritually dwarfed women, loaded down with the burden of their sins and easily swayed and led away by various evil desires and seductive impulses. These weak women will listen to anybody who will teach them. They are forever inquiring and getting information, but are never able to arrive at a recognition and knowledge of the truth. I think we're there. I think the way that they work their way into homes is through the television. I think there are women that sit at home, watch the television. They're getting all this information from doctor this and judge this and judge that and so forth and so forth. And it's erroneous information. And their hearts and their minds are becoming dissatisfied. They're dissatisfied with their children, dissatisfied with their home, dissatisfied with their husbands, dissatisfied, going to find something better, something new, something great. It's destructive. So you don't watch that stuff. You don't do that. You clean your life up. Come on, moms. You wouldn't give your children dirty food. Well, then you don't give them dirty anything. You want what flows through you to be good milk. You want the milk of the Word to be flowing through you into that child. You want to teach that child respect for authority by teaching them respect for their father. Then you want to teach them respect for all authority, because all authority comes from God. These are things that moms can do. These are things that moms used to do. And these are things that moms have to do. That's the challenge that's set before us. The hand that rules the world. They say that man is mighty. He governs land and sea. He wields a mighty scepter or lesser powers that be. By a mightier power and stronger, man from his throne is hurled, and the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Blessings on the hand of woman. Angels guard its strength and grace. In the palace, cottage, hovel, oh, no matter where the place, wood that never storms assailed it, rainbows ever gently curried, for the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Infancy's the tender fountain, power may with beauty flow. Mother's first to guide the streamlets, from them souls unresting grow. Grow on for the good or evil, sunshine streamed or darkness hurled, for the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Woman, how divine your mission here upon our natal sod. Keep, oh keep the young heart open always to the breath of God. All true trophies of the ages are from mother love imperiled. For the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Blessings on the hand of woman. Fathers, sons, and daughters cry, and the sacred song is mingled with the worship in the sky. Mingled where no tempest darkens, rainbows evermore are curled. For the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Mom, the greatest, most honorable thing that you will ever have laid before you is the privilege of rearing one of God's children. They are God's, placed into your custody and care. And the privilege of taking something so special, where Jesus said, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, for as such are the kingdom of God." The privilege of being the one that kisses them, loves them, hugs them, provides for them, lays down the faithfulness of God into their life by providing their needs, their physiological needs, love and belonging needs. Going back to what I said, children that are not touched and loved and cared for, you can put them into daycare, you can provide for them lunches, you can do all this stuff, but in the end, they will not be what God intended for them to be, unless they get born again and the Spirit of God leads them into the truth of God's Word and begins to provide the needs for them. Who's going to rock the cradle in the United States of America? You, Mom, or the federal government? Who's going to rock the cradle and put the truth into their hearts? You, Mom, or the state government? Who's going to rock the cradle? Who's going to pick up the challenge of creating the heroes and the heroines and the strong men and the strong women of the next generation? If you think it's the government, you're wrong, because it's never worked. The only one that can do that job the way it's supposed to be done is you, Mom. God bless you. Let's stand. Who's the greatest? Irma, Louise, Moore. My mom. Nobody else was ever my mom. Nobody else ever wanted to be my mom. In fact, Mrs. Moore now tells me I am not your mom. She said, "What are you going to buy me for Mother's Day?" I said, "I thought you told me that I wasn't your mom, or you weren't my mom." Said, get your children out there and let them buy you something. So what I do, I bought her a new coffee pot that she wanted. Can we not be dynamic people? Can't we come back to the standards that made this country great and made families great and sit around tables again at least once a day and somebody comes in, prays a prayer blessing over the food and we talk about the challenges together, the hurts, the disappointments. Can't there be someone around that table that says, "Okay, so he did do that to you, and he has been vicious and mean to you. Let's do what Jesus said. Let's just lift that person up before you right now." Because chances are, the reason that kid is a bully is because his needs aren't met. Let's ask Jesus to provide a way that those needs can be met. Let's us be the one that shows love where there's only been disrespect for that child. You don't know what's going on in some kid's life. You don't know what happens to them. You know, I used to get so upset sometimes because I thought every child was supposed to desire deeply to be a historian. What? You don't love United States history? What's wrong with you? But you find out that that same kid that's not paying any attention to history is going to go home and be abused. He's going to go home and have drugs or alcohol or some other terrible thing. He's going to go home and there's not going to be any love there. He's going to go home to being bullied by siblings. You don't know what some child's going through. But you can be the lifeline. You can still dispense love. And I want to challenge you to do that. And be especially nice to mom. She carries an awful load. You know, my mom would never sit down to eat until everybody at the table had their food on their plate. She'd spend hours at night up with me and then go to work the next day. Why? Because she loved this little guy that she had brought into the world. And I respect her. And I am looking forward to her being at the pearly gate. And I'm going to say thank you, Mom. I did my best to live the life that you showed me.
Okay. Good morning. We are the Hambo Choir from Fairton Christian Center Academy, and the song that we will be playing for you today is entitled "All Creatures of Our God and King."
Thank you.
ensemble from Fairton Christian Center Academy. And the song that we will be singing for you today is entitled, We Sing Alleluia with Be Holy.